right? I have a little business that funds all of this. Okay, I pay for all of this out of my pocket. I've given my music out for free. I've traveled across country in order to perform for free and do things for free like that, all at my expense. The guys over at Polygraph, they said, hey, why don't you come over here and do a show? We'll pay you something. I said, man, don't even worry about it because the message is more important. God has blessed me with being able to fund this operation myself. Finally, I put my CD for sale, only because I want to cover the cost of printing. That's it, and that's all it's doing is covering the cost of printing right now. But, yeah, I think Bill Cooper said it best. He says, you don't get rich doing this. You go broke. You go very, very, very broke.
Exactly. I just want to let everybody know out there, we're not getting paid by anybody to do this. We're doing this at the expense of our time that we should be spending together. You know,
and we argue sometimes.
Because
sometimes, it gets so stressful.
Exactly. It gets really stressful. I mean, consider the fact that we spend probably at least 15 hours a week doing this.
Yeah.
And, you know,
I mean, we got a two-hour show, but we got preparation we got to do, too.
Exactly, and testing the mics,
yep.
You know, keeping the equipment updated and everything. And it sucks. And you know what? We're not asking for donations.
Nope. I don't want anything from anybody.
Exactly, me either.
I just want them to listen. That's all I want is for people to listen and share the information amongst each other.
You know, that's good enough for us. We're completely fine with people just listening to what we have to say.
Amen. Hey, should we go into some news? We've still got a little bit of time left.
Yeah. Out of UPI.com, Blackwater founder tells of secret CIA aid. Out of Washington, December 3rd, the founder of Blackwater Worldwide, the U.S. military contractor employed in Iraq and Afghanistan, says he helped secret CIA programs targeting Al-Qaeda. Eric Prince, owner of the security company now known as Z Services, told Vanity Fair in an interview he performed very risky missions for the spy agency while deflecting blame from the CIA if something went wrong. We were building a unilateral, unattributable capability, he was quoted as saying. If it went bad, we weren't expecting anyone to bail us out. He's a former Navy SEAL. He said he carried out secret missions as recently as 2 months ago, when the Obama administration terminated his contract after media leaks revealed the operation. The magazine granted rare access to Blackwater facilities in the United States and Afghanistan, said Prince served a dual role for the CIA as both a contractor and spy who also ran intelligence gathering operations. Against who? Al-Qaeda. Think about
this.
They're
running
off
against
themselves. This is stupid. This is like somebody playing Monopoly against themselves.
I know. But we've been saying this for years. I mean, everybody's been saying it for years. We, as in the alternative media, that it's all CIA run, it's all one person holding the strings, and it's just amazing to see the mainstream media start to echo what the alternative media is saying. And my saying has always been, when you hear the mainstream media start saying the same things as Alex Jones and David Icke and everybody like that, you need to watch the hell out.
And did you know that 3 months ago, Keith Olbermann basically came out and said that Blackwater and Eric Prince himself were caught basically shipping in prostitutes from foreign countries?
Yeah.
Little girls.
Yeah, I know. I remember that.
Yeah, 3 months ago. So, yeah, that's probably one of the reasons why their contract got terminated.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that whole war in Afghanistan, I think, was about the poppy fields and the drugs.
Yeah, it was. It was about drug trafficking.
Right, right.
It wasn't about freedom for Iraqis or Afghanis or Al-Qaeda. It was about the drugs.
You know what's getting me right now, though, is I'm seeing a lot of articles about the mainstream media becoming more closed, and they're trying to block off all the alternative media as well. Like,
mm-hmm.
Rupert Murdoch has just started to try to charge people for the information on his website. So
he's trying to choke us out.
Yeah, he's trying to choke Google out first, which is kind of weird. It's like the left hand and the right hand.
Because it provides the news feature. He doesn't like people being able to search Google News for, like, certain words like Blackwater or, you know, Rosebud or anything like that and then find the articles they want to find.
Right. So now's the time when we need to fight back, ladies and gentlemen. And that's why we had the little rant at the beginning of the show, because everybody needs to get out here and start a radio show. Okay? Everybody needs to get out here and start a website, start a forum.
Exactly.
But don't start a forum dedicated to bashing another researcher.
And we'll, as long as it's not bashing another researcher, we will plug the hell out of it.
Yeah, that was the whole reason we created the show, is to get some of these smaller guys that can't get a break to get on here. We've been graced by God to be able to get some great guests, though. Rob Menard, the anti-terrorist, a few more that we have coming up here in the future. But as you saw, we started out with anti-Illuminati, Polygia, these small researchers who are really making an impact. So, yes, we urge everybody, if you start a forum, if you start this and that, give us a call. Let us know.
We'll be more than
happy
to plug
in. Yeah, more than happy to have you on the show and things like that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. That was our whole goal to begin with, was to give people a platform to be able to express their views and plug their stuff that they've created.
Exactly. And I think you'll find some really interesting guests on our show, some of the bigger researchers, some of the smaller researchers, but all the information is just great. We've been blessed with an exclusive interview by The Anti-Terrorist. You can see his work at youtube.com/TheAntiTerrorist, and he also has The Anti-Terrorist Handbook available on Amazon. So without any further ado, let's go straight to the interview, and I want to stress to everybody that this was pre-recorded because we wanted to protect his identity, he wanted to protect his identity, and so on and so forth. So, Socio, why don't you go ahead and field the first question?
Well, here's a first series of questions. First of all, why do you disguise your voice? How'd you get started in all this? And can you tell us a little bit about yourself?
First of all, I'm acutely aware that this isn't Truth Frequency's regular format, so I'd like to thank them very much for going the extra mile to accommodate my privacy concerns. At the risk of saying too much about my private life, my profession requires that I keep a low profile, politically speaking. If my employers were to become aware of me denouncing the current system, it would certainly mean the end of my career, hence the clandestine facade. I'm well aware that for some the mask and the voice might be off-putting, but I hoped it would grab their attention long enough for the information to hit home. Although I've got strong opinions on many subjects, and I was committed to sharing them, I wasn't about to jeopardize my ability to feed and clothe my family. I was also acutely aware that should it turn out I was just a misguided nutcase, and that all was actually well with the world, I could drop the project like a hot potato and blend back in with no embarrassment to those who associate with me on a regular basis. But aside from that aspect, privacy is a cornerstone of freedom, and I guard my privacy fiercely. I guess what really started for me was intense anger and frustration a couple of years ago, but this has since modified into a sincere desire to inspire others to empower themselves. The best comments I get are from people who also get it, that self-empowerment comes from thinking for themselves and educating themselves instead of waiting around to be told what to do by anyone else.
You know, I completely agree that self-empowerment comes from within yourself, and that's what we need to do, is change what's going on inside, change the way that we think. I remember David Icke talking about changing the movie screen, and people are yelling at the movie screen, and unless you change the movie, you're never going to get anywhere. And I never understood what that meant, but what that means is looking inside of you and changing the way you think, changing the way you perceive the world, changing your reality, and then that empowers you, and you can move forward from there.
The next question we asked him was, is there any one particular event that was the straw that broke the camel's back, so to speak, or was this something that grew over time?
Well, I think I've had the proverbial splinter in the back of my mind for some time now, but I was initially inspired to broadcast based on events I'd witnessed outside Parliament in 2007 concerning a certain anti-war protester named Brian Hall. Now, Brian doesn't know me, but I've been an advocate of his stand since it began. He lawfully occupies an area of about 5 square meters outside Parliament, and he's thwarted all attempts to remove him since he made camp there about 6 years ago in protest against the unlawful invasion of Iraq. He's a thorn in the side of the establishment, to say the least. In fact, thanks to the internet and the power of his message, he's become something of a tourist attraction. The police have tried every dirty trick in the book to remove him. I've been witness to bullying, coercion, violence, and threats of imprisonment, but it just seems to make him more determined to stay. Brian is a passionate but peaceable soul, and to the best of my knowledge, he's never raised a hand against another. He has my profound respect. In 2008, a few policy enforcement officers wearing SWAT-type gear accosted him. He was dragged into the back of a waiting van and was allegedly the test dummy for a bout of truncheon practice. He emerged some 5 minutes later, bloodied and battered, but as defiant as ever. I wasn't there to see the event with my own eyes, but there are hundreds of photographs and several video recordings of the incident available on the net. I think what disgusted me most was the general reaction of the onlookers. They walked by as though nothing of any significance had happened. And once Brian had been carted off in an ambulance, the police stationed around Parliament nonchalantly continued to direct human traffic. You know how that goes. Nothing to see here, folks. Move along now. The general level of apathy in this once great country is so pervasive and so apparent,